Okay, so let me start with the part one, Introduction to Radar Polarimetry. Okay, so first of all, we have to underline that polarimetry is a very important application in the both radar and synthetic aperture radar context. In fact, with the polarimetry, by using a fully polarimetric SAR or radar, we can extract more and more information from the observed scene in place of using a conventional radar system that uses a single polarization. Currently, there are many airborne and spaceborne polarimetric SAR systems, such as ISAR, PSAR, and so on. RADARSAT, TerraSAR X, and so on, and many others. And in particular, with all these platforms, a huge mass of fully polarimetric data have been acquired during the years. As to the applications, we can see that polarimetry is applied in many fields, such as agriculture, oceanography, forestry, disaster monitoring, like oil spill detection, just to mention one specific application, as well as military, such as target recognition. Okay, what is the polarization? To understand polarization, we have to recall that electromagnetic waves propagates following a specific direction, and the electric and magnetic fields oscillates on a plane that is orthogonal to this direction. In particular, as we can see in this picture, we have that polarization is the direction of the electric field vector that oscillates on this plane that is orthogonal to the direction given by chi. And in particular, if this vector oscillates always in the same direction, we say that the polarization is linear. Otherwise, the polarization is circular or elliptic. So polarization gives information about how the electromagnetic wave is transmitted and received. And so we can see that target reflection properties, like the radar cross-section, is a function of the polarization of the incident wave. Now we have also to recall the Faraday rotation effect that can be found in some propagation medium. In particular, some medium has the property to change the polarization state of the incident wave that travels inside this medium. And this is called repolarization of the electromagnetic wave. So we need to use some calibration target to estimate and remove this effect from the measured scattering matrix. Of course, after calibration, it is important to apply some procedures on the image that have been acquired, such as the speckle filtering, the fissure extraction, and so it is possible to perform the target detection and classification. It is also important to recall that the scattering matrix or the covariance matrix, we'll see some details in the next, can be related, can be decomposed in order to relate different parts of these different components of these matrices as related to single bound scattering, double bound scattering, and volume scattering. Some important decompositions are listed here, such as the Krogagre decomposition, the Claude-Pottier decomposition, and so on. Of course, we do not focus on these decompositions in this talk. We only talk about Krogagre decomposition in the fifth part. It is also important to extract features used to understand the similarity between two matrices. Okay, what is the scattering matrix? In particular, the first idea is that if we consider a wave that is horizontally polarized, so that has a linear polarization and that is horizontal, and if we observe the backscattered wave from the target, we can see contributions in both horizontal and vertical polarizations. And the same, of course, if we transmit with the vertical polarization. So we can describe the electromagnetic wave using a complete basis set that comprises both horizontal and vertical components. And so we can construct a so-called scattering matrix S that is here represented. So we have that the electric field here indicated with the superscript S, that is the scattered wave, is related to the incident wave by means of the scattering matrix that has these four components. Of course, if we consider a monostatic radar and we assume that the reciprocity theorem is valid, we have that the off-diagonal elements are equal. So SHV is equal to SVH. And so the scattering matrix is composed by three independent elements. Now we can construct the scattering vectors KC that is given assuming reciprocity in this form. And in particular, we can also consider a power domain representation that is given by the covariance matrix, computed as the statistical mean of the product KC times KC dagger. Dagger is the transpose and the conjugates. And this is the expression of the covariance matrix. In the same way, we can consider the poly spin elements, and so we can consider a new vector KT that is a bit different from the previous one, but it is always used because its elements have a physical interpretation of odd bounds, even bounds, and so on. And by using this vector in the power domain form, we obtain the coherence matrix. The important properties of these two matrices is that their eigenvalues are the same. So these two matrices, the coherence and the covariance, have the same eigenvalues that are also real. And also the sum of the diagonal elements, that is the trace of the matrix that gives the total power of the scattered wave is also the same. Okay, so let me see some applications. Of course, we can refer to target detection, discrimination, and recognition. That is the process by which we separate and classify the returns from a resolution cell that are due to target clutter and noise. In particular, in the detection process, we can use some well-known techniques to separate the target from clutter returns. Then, once we have detected the target, we can discriminate between potential targets of interest and target-like responses of clutter. And so, by doing this, we can discriminate target. Finally, the last operation is the recognition that allows us to classify different targets. Okay, now to study the target behavior We can consider the high frequency backscattering from a complex target, and we can consider this complex phenomenon as due to the specular scattering and the edge diffraction. So we can see the wave that is backscattered from the target as given by the coherent sum of the contributions given by a finite number of discrete scattering centers. So we can see the targets as composed by a certain number of elementary scattering centers. Of course, the wave that is scattered back by the target is related to the shape of the target and, of course, also to the material of the specific target. A first study has been conducted by Professor Julie that considered a radar polarimetric data of an aircraft target. And in particular, he measured the scattering covariance matrix in S band with a pulse length of 1 microsecond and a pulse repetition frequency of 1 kHz with a dwell time of 20 microseconds. He has considered a right circular polarization and received both the circular polarization in right and left side. Then he has studied the received signal and what he has obtained. He has obtained these results that the target eco-polarization states did not change much during the dwell time of any one scan, but changed considerably between scans, indicated a small degree of depolarization with time. So this is the result of Professor Julie. Now we can see how it is possible to extract features from target, of course, related to polarimetry. So what we can do is to consider the so-called two-dimensional spectral analysis applied to some radar radars in order to create a so-called range rate image of the target. And of course, this image is pixelated in terms of radar resolution cells. So, what we can compute is the so-called two-dimensional spectral components in the data that is associated with a particular scatterer of the target. The phase behavior as a function of frequency and time determines the scatterer's range and range rate. The amplitude coefficient instead determines its radar cross-section. So what we can compute is the two-dimensional Fourier transform to obtain this spectral analysis. Of course, there are also other methods developed during the years. One of them is the so-called ESPRIT, and also there are also some subspace-based techniques. Okay, here we can see an example. So here we have our target, and that is a cone, and the fully polarimetric monostatic radar cross-section of this object has been measured at the Lincoln Laboratory. In particular, we can see that this cone has some grooves here, and here of a few millimeters size. In these figures, we can see a picture of the target, and here we can see the result of the ESPRIT image, and here the Fourier image. In this last figure, we can see the Fourier image superimposed to the target. So we can see that the improvement that SPRIT processing provides, both in sharpness and spectral splatter, is striking. In particular, what we can see that there is the phantom scatterer here that is behind the base of the cone and is the result of the doubly diffracted ray that crosses the flat base of the target from one edge to the other. And of course, this point causes an extended return in radar target signatures. And so, for instance, this point can be exploited as a feature to distinguish between a true target and a fake target. Okay, so here we can see a cone observed by using an X-band radar at 10 GHz that is again monostatic, and in particular we can see the VV polarization on the left and the HH polarization on the right. Again, we have the three grooves on the target. And now it is evident that bare targets tend to polarize the target return because there is a clear distinction between the VV and HH return at edges and points. Okay, now we have this question. Are there other aspect angles and target scattering features that one can exploit to provide better contrast between coated and bare targets? Because, of course, we have a different in target returns if we have a coated target or a bare target. And in particular, in target identification, mostly features such as specular returns, based edges, and joints, and both of them, are employed in the discrimination phase. The problem is that these features also produce diffused scattering. And so the problem is that the scattering centers depend on the aspect angle. Okay, here we can see though another example, and we can see that this cylinder is coated with a dielectric, like in the previous case, and we can see that we have two phenomena, the creeping waves here and the specular reflection. Here we can see the results, and we can see a strong difference between the VV case and the HH case. In fact, in the HH case, we do not have these strong returns that instead is present in the VV case. Okay, so now we can see how to perform the measurement of the scattering matrix. And in particular, we can see that this is a four-element scattering matrices. And so to obtain a measure of this scattering matrix, we have to know that it depends on the aspect angle, on the orientation, and also on frequency. Okay, so as shown in this figure, we can see that the aspect angle is defined as the angle between the radar line of sight and the axis of the target. And also the orientation angle is the target rotation about the line of sight. So as you can see in this picture. Of course, we consider a reference system located at the radar system. Okay, so we can consider the scattering matrix as a linear in a linear polarization basis, but we can also transform it to a circular polarization basis. Of course, we can consider reciprocity if it applies, and so we can reduce the number of measurements, and we can characterize the scattering matrix in two ways. The first one is the complex voltage type scattering matrix, in which we have to measure the absolute phase of the target return, or we can also consider the real power type that is called the Carnot matrix K, but it do not depend on the target phase. Of course, we refer to the first case. In particular, what we have to consider is the scattering matrix with the absolute phase, that even if it is difficult to obtain because we need to measure the absolute phase, but it is the most complete case. Okay, so what we need to perform this measurement? We need to radiate two orthogonal transmitted polarization. So we need to transmit two different polarization. And then we have to simultaneously observe on a dual polarized orthogonal receiver channels the scattered returns. So it is not simple to obtain this acquisition. This is done by using this scheme. We do not need to go into details, but what we have to see is that what we need. We need a coherent oscillator. Then we need to have on transmission that the output of the coherent oscillation is mixed with the frequency of a stable local oscillator, and is up converted to a radio frequency, because we have, of course, to transmit to the specific radio frequency at which we want to measure our scattering matrix. Of course, then we should be able to receive both polarization, so the two orthogonal polarization. Okay, now we can go to the part two, that is how to assess reciprocity in polarimetric SAR data. In particular, we have said that reciprocity theorem means that SHV should be equal to SVH. But in some cases, we cannot have that these two elements are equal. So in this specific case, what we can do? We can perform a mean between these two channels in order to have a single channel used in place of these two channels, or if it is not possible, we have to consider that the reciprocity theorem is not valid. But to verify if the reciprocity theorem is valid, we have to perform, we can perform a statistical test on our data. So, starting from our data, we can formulate our problem as a binary hypothesis test, where the reciprocity is given in H0, whereas the lack of reciprocity is given in H1. And in particular, this problem has been solved thanks to the generalized likelihood ratio test. To do this, we have first of all to construct a data cube for our polarimetric channels. In particular, as you can see, each image, each channel, as indicated here, is considered as a matrix. And so we have to form a data cube that comprises all four channels. Then we consider a sliding window to test for the pixel under test that is given here in yellow. So we consider the polarimetric returns, that is, for instance, the vector of size 4 that has the polarimetric returns of this specific pixel, that are modeled as independent and identically distributed zero mean circular symmetric complex Gaussian vectors with the covariance matrix M1 if we have a non-reciprocal medium and M0 if the medium is reciprocal. So our problem is given by this binary hypothesis test, H0 reciprocity, H1 non-reciprocity. So under H0 hypothesis, the covariance matrix can be structured in this way, where in particular gamma square accounts for thermal noise, and here we have that M bar is a 2x2 matrix. So if reciprocity is valid and so the structure is like this, we have that in place of these four values, we have three values in the scattering matrix. So we have SHH, SVV, SHV, SHV. Okay, so under this hypothesis, we can further simplify the previous matrix in this way, where all these elements are described below. But I want to leave directly to the result. In particular, we resort to the generalized likelihood ratio test. So we have to maximize over M1 the likelihood under H1, and we have to perform the ratio with respect to the maximum likelihood under H0 with respect to M0. And it can be shown that the results of this problem is given by this test. So we have this simple test in which all details are reported here, or you can find in the related paper. And by performing this test with a specific threshold, we can assess if the reciprocity is valid H0 or not H1. So to test this, this method, we can consider, we can generate some data with a specific covariance matrix, that is in particular a scene. This represents a scene composed of trees. And as we can see here, we can plot the detection probability with respect to the parameter xi. This parameter xi rules the fact that M1 bar goes toward the case of H0 or H1. And in particular, we'll see three different cases. If there is a perfect match, a perfect phase matching between the two channels, HV and VH, a random phase variation in two different intervals. And the first thing that we can see is that increasing the number of data in the sliding window that we use to perform estimation, we improve the performance, as you can see, the green line. And also we can see that passing xi from 0 to 1, we go to a detection performance, a poor detection performance, to a good detection performance. Here we can see some tests conducted on real recorded data, and in particular, test one is on an L-band data at 1.25 GHz, and the second test performed in the C-bands. As you can see here, in the first case, we can see that in this map, this is of course the scene, in this map we can see that only few points are associated to H1. So the reciprocity is valid for this image. In this second case, we have that the pixel belonging to H1 is only the 3%. So also in this case, we can assume that reciprocity is valid because almost all pixels are associated to H0. Of course, we can perform this also in other cases for other images. And here you can find all the references for this part.